We would not have been from the people of the hellfire. Also Allah tabarak wa ta'ala tells us, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he tells us that the comprehension of the nusus al-wahyain, by listening to it, in that verse in Surah Al-Mulk, what did he say? They're going to regret the Day of Judgment. And that they are going to be? Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says about the disbelievers, وَلَقَدْ ذَرَأْنَا لِجَهَنَّمَ كَثِيرًا مِنَ الْإِنْجِ وَلَقَدْ ذَرَأْنَا لِجَهَنَّمَ كَثِيرًا مِنَ الْجِنِّ وَالْإِنْسِ لَهُمْ قُلُوبٌ لَا يَفْقَهُونَ بِهَا. They have hearts, but they are unable to understand. The understanding of the heart, what is it connected to? وَلَهُمْ آذَانٌ. That's what the ayah says. وَلَهُمْ آذَانٌ لَا يَسْمَعُونَ بِهَا. They have ears, they don't hear the haq when it's being said to them. And the people of misguidance and the people of kufr, that's how they always were. When the Prophet came to them, they would always place their fingers in their ears. And they would not want to listen. As Allah said in Surah An-Nuh. وَإِنِّي كُلَّمَا دَعَوْتُهُمْ لِتَغْفِرَ لَهُمْ جَعَلُوا أَصَابِعَهُمْ فِي آذَانِهِمْ وَاسْتَغْشَوْا ثِيَابَهُمْ وَأَسَرُّوا وَاسْتَكْبَرُوا اسْتِكْبَارًا. They take their fingers and they place it in their ears and they become arrogant. Why? What was the Prophet calling them to? So Allah can forgive them. Guidance. Hidayatul dalalatu wal irshad. He's showing them the right path. Well, listen to me. وَلِذَلِكَ the Prophets, what did they say to their people? فَتَوَلَّ عَنْهُمْ وَقَالَ يَا قَوْمِ لَقَدْ أَبْلَغْتُكُمْ رِسَالَةَ رَبِّي وَنَصَحْتُ لَكُمْ وَلَكِنْ لَا تُحِبُّونَ النَّاصِحِينَ. My people, I have advised you guys. I have brought the haq to you guys. But you guys are a people who don't want to take the advice. The sincere advice of those who are sincere in their advising towards you. So it's important to listen to the ulama. So the Shaykh said, isma', listen. This listening is a listening of wanting guidance for yourself. A listening of what? A tadabbur wa ta'ammul. A listening of comprehending the information that's been given to you. Analyzing it. Digesting and pondering on it. Contemplating. That type of listening. But there's a difference between listening and hearing. The issue isn't to hear. The issue is to listen. And that's what it means. Isma', listen. كلام محقق. What does he mean by a كلام محقق في قوله? محقق في قوله, it means a person who, yeah, what does he do? ينطلق, who picks up from. محقق here means what? A person who, when he brings his evidence forward, or brings his arguments forward, or he brings his point forward, he's basing upon what? Tahqiq, the reality, which is the kitab, and the sunnah, and the ijma' of the salaf of this ummah, how they unanimously agreed upon in this matter. So listen to the speech of a person who is going to what? Who is going to extract every point he mentions from the kitab, from the sunnah, and from the ijma' of the salaf of this ummah. Muhaqqiqin fi qawli. His speech is tahqiq. It's not what? Mujarradi da'awa. Mere claims. Now this is what it is, and this is what it is. ولذلك, I previously mentioned, brothers and sisters, I previously mentioned that madhhabu salaf, the path of the salaf, how is it known? How can one say, this is what the salaf were upon? How does he say it? I brought you statements after statements. One of the best statements, or one of the statements that answer this question is qawl, the speech of who? Abu Qasim al-Taymi, Qawm al-Sunnah. In his book, what? Al-Hujjah fi Bayan al-Mahajjah. Darul Raya published it. Darul Raya, they published it. When he answered that point, he said, وَمَذْهَبُ السَّلَفِ يُعْرَفُ بِالنَّقْلِ. The path of the pious predecessors is known by naql. Person brings forward to you what they said. Here it is. And the scholars that have done that, who have brought you the views of the scholars, with its chain of narration, is Abu Qasim Hibatullah Ilalaka'iyu. In his great book, Sharh Usul I'tiqadi Ahli Sunnah. So you go back to that book. Also, I've given you previously a statement by Imam al-Dhahabi. That's one way to know the Madhab al-Salaf. A transmission. Qala Malik ibn Anas, al-istiwa'u ma'alum, wal-kayfu majhul, wal-su'alu anhu bid'ah. See the statement of who? Imam Malik. This matter of al-Rahman al-Ashri istawa. Or Abu Ali said this. You go to Khalq Af'al al-Ibad by Bukhari, rahimahullah ta'ala. Or you go to Ibn Bukhari in his tafsir, in his sahih, in his sahih. In the bab where he brought the call of Abu Aliya, Al-Rayahi. What did he say? That Ar-Rahman al-Arsh istawa mean what? Irtafa. Allah is above his throne. Transmission of the statement of the alim. That's the first one. The second one is what? It is what a person who is muttali', who reads, who is an imam, muhaqqiq, who knows the aqwal of the salaf very well, such as Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, who we took how the scholars have spoken about his knowledge and how he knew the speeches of the scholars salaf. He will say that to you, he will say to you, Mujahid said this, Ata said this, Muhammad ibn Sirin said this, Fudayl ibn Iyad said this, he'll bring you, Malik ibn Anas said this, Ishaq ibn Rahuya, Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Ali ibn al-Madini, al-Imam, Abu Isa ibn Sawrat al-Tirmidhi said this, to bring you the aqwal of the ulama. So you say, Bukhari believe this, and Shafi'i believe this, and Muhammad believe this, and Malik believe this. And at the end of this book, what does he say? After he gives you all of the issues that he speaks about in the matters of aqa'id, he says to you at the ending of the book, وهذا اعتقاد الشافعي ومالك وأبي حنيفة ثم أحمد ينقلوا. Something like that. That this is the madhab of who? الشافعي, أحمد, أبو حنيفة, أحمد بن حنبل. This is their belief. The four أئمة الأربعة who are followed by the ummah today, this is their belief. So don't think that the aqidah of Ahmed and Shafi'i and Abu Hanifa and Malik ibn Anas, they were different aqidah issues. No, they differed on matters of fiqh, like they didn't differ on matters of aqaid. All of them were together. Yaddun wahid, one hand, all of them. Naam. So, the Shaykh is saying to Muhaqqiq, who brings you, Qala Allah, Qala al-Rasul, and the aqwal of the Salaf. Isma' listen, kalama muhaqqiqin fi qawlihi, a person who is in his speech, he'll pick up from the kitab and the sunnah and the ijma' of the Salaf of this ummah. لا ينثني عنه ولا يتبدل. لا ينثني means what? لا يرجع عنه. He doesn't come back from it. Ha. ولا يتبدل. يتبدل means what? That these speeches don't change. They are the haq. They are clear cut. And he won't change it. It means that he won't do interpretations which are batil. There are some people who will say to you, this is matter is a ta'wil. هذا لا يقال تأويل. You don't call it a ta'wil. Ta'wil is a lafd mujmal. Pay attention. The word ta'wil, that somebody will say to you, oh, Allah's characteristics, they done ta'wil of this. Learn that usually the word ta'wil is not a sensible word. Because the word ta'wil is a very, what, vague word. When we say vague, we mean what? It's an ambiguous, it has ambiguity in it. The word ta'wil has what? Ambiguity in it. Why do we say there's ambiguity and vagueness in it? Because that word, it can take what? More than one meaning. And there are praiseworthy meaning in it and a blameworthy meaning in it. So don't use the word ta'wil. That's why Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, in his argument, munadharatuhu fi aqidat al-wasatiyya, when he argued in aqidat al-wasatiyya, Ibn Taymiyyah mentions what? That he didn't use in his book the word ta'wil. He said, I didn't use the word ta'wil. I used the word tahrif. Not the word ta'wil. Why? Because he said, I know that the word ta'wil, it has a good meaning in it. But the word tahrif, does it have a good meaning? No, tahrif means distortion. So these people, what they do is, they do distortion. As Allah said about the Jews, يُحَرِّفُونَ الْكَلِمَ عَمَّ وَضِعِهِ. They change and they distort the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tahrif. What do? Tahrif. And that argument of Aqidat al-Wasatiyya with Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. And I said this to you guys before. Ibn Taymiyyah, whenever he came to these places and he argued with his opponents, he would always have his Aqidat al-Wasatiyya with him. Whenever they argued, this is my Aqidah, what do you have problem? Hadi Aqidati. This is my Aqidah. This is what I believe. If you have a problem, argue with this issue and we'll talk about it. Aqidat al-Wasatiyya, Ibn Taymiyyah used to use it as his what? As his Aqidah. This is my Aqidah. And he had arguments based on Aqidat al-Wasatiyya. And the debate in its totality, who wrote it? Ibn Abdul Hadi brings it, is Uqood al-Durriya. And also, previously, Muhammad Muhibb al-Khatib, rahimahullah, when he brought the book Aqidat al-Wasatiyya, he also brought with it what? He also brought with it the munadara. The debate is in there. So اسمع listen كلام محقق في قوله لا ينثني عنه ولا يتبدل. That Then the Shaykh goes into a matter which is from the usul of Ahlul Sunnah. Now I want you to all listen, inshallah ta'ala, and understand this point. Which is what? If a person goes against Ahlul Sunnah in three things, they're an innovator. Three things. A person becomes an innovator. If he goes against Ahlul Sunnah in any of these three, he's a mubtadi'. The first thing is that if he goes against Ahlul Sunnah in the place where he takes his evidences from, Mazdarul Talaqi, where you take your evidence from. If you take your evidences from logic and intellect over the Kitab and the Sunnah and the Salaf of this Ummah, you're a mubtadi'. Because Ahlul Sunnah, what are we? Where do we take our matters of aqa'id from? Al-Kitab wa Sunnah? Bifahmi Salaf al-Ummah. We spoke about that before. Our Mazdarul Talaqi is what? Al-Kitab wa Sunnah wa Ijma'u Salaf al-Ummah. The Salaf of this Ummah, what they unanimously agreed upon. Are you with me? Very good. That's anyone who goes against Ahlul Sunnah in the place where they take the evidences from is a mubtada. The second thing is what? Anyone who goes against Ahlul Sunnah in a asal, a fundamental matter, min usul Ahlul Sunnah, from the fundamental matters of Ahlul Sunnah. And are you with me? And they are these five. They are what? They are these five. The first one is masail, which are matters pertaining to what? Al-asma'i wa sifat. Allah's names and what? Allah's attributes. Allah's names and what? Allah's attributes, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anyone who goes against Ahlul Sunnah in the names and the attributes and doesn't affirm Allah's names nor Allah's attributes, or he affirms the names only and he doesn't affirm the attributes, then that person goes against what? Ahlul Sunnah. He's a innovator. That's one. The second one is what? And matters which are masail asma' wal ahkam, matters which pertain to names and its rulings, names and its what? Its rulings. What do I mean by that? Anyone who goes against Ahlul Sunnah in matters like al iman, al kufr, al nifaq, al fisq, al dhulm, these are terminology bid'ah. These are terminologies which are what? They are masail. They are they are names and they have ahkam revolving around. They got rulings that are connected to it. So when a person becomes a kafir, there are rulings that revolve around it, which is what? First of all, he's not buried with the Muslims. His wife is automatically separated from him. If there's an Islamic state, he gets killed. He's not buried then with the Muslims. We can't ask Allah's mercy for him. He doesn't inherit. He's not inherited. All of those. So this name, kufr, which we place on a person, it has ahkam that come from it. It's not just to say kafir, like that. So if you go against Ahlul Sunnah in the way you used the word kufr, you go against Ahlul Sunnah, you just throw at everyone you see. You don't look at itlaqul hukum, the general ruling, and you don't look at the specific ruling. You don't look at the shurut, you don't look at the mawani', you don't observe any of that. Then you go against what? Ahlul Sunnah in this issue. The third thing is what? The third thing is مسائل التوسط في الصحابة, and to be balanced in the matter pertaining to the Sahabas. When I say توسط and to be balanced in the matters pertaining to the Sahabas, what do I mean by that? I mean there's a group that went extreme regarding the Sahabas, and there are a group of people who went short regarding the Sahabas. The group that went extreme regarding the Sahabas are who? The Rawafid and the Shia, that took Ali beyond his level and they reached him to what? They made him an ilah. The Rafidah, the Shia, they took Ali ibn Abi Talib and they gave him a level of uluhiyah. To be specific, not the Rafidah, the Shia. And amongst the Shia, the Nusayriyah, they taken Ali and they made him what? Ilah. They worship him. They what? They worship him. So those people, what did? They done ghulu, extreme in the issue of what? The Sahabas. They go against Ahlul Sunnah in this issue. Rather, they become kuffar because of it. And the Nusayriyah, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he said about them in his Minhaj al-Sunnah al-Nabawiyyah, hum akfaru min al-Yahudi wal-Nasara. Their kufr is greater than the Christians and the Jews. Good. And there's a group who went short. The Khawarij. What did they do? Kaffaru al-Sahaba. Uthman, they said he's a kafir. Muawiyah, they said he's a kafir. And Ali ibn Abi Talib, they done takfir on him and they killed him. Like AbdulRahman ibn Muljim, he killed Ali ibn Abi Talib as a kafir. So they went another extreme. So Ahlul Sunnah, regarding the Sahabas, which we're going to speak about, as it's the first thing that the Shaykh mentioned from the five. So I've mentioned three. The fourth one is Masail al-Wa'd wal-Wa'id. Masail al-Wa'd wal-Wa'id. Promises that come in the Quran and the Sunnah, and the warnings that are in the Quran and the Sunnah. There are a group who went extreme on both angles, like the Khawarij and the Murji'ah. What did the Murji'ah do? They took all the nusus that give promises. Man qala la ilaha illallah, anyone who says that will enter Jannah. So then if you come with any naqid, anything that nullifies your Islam, it doesn't matter as long as you say la ilaha illallah. You see, they took the actions out of Iman. And then the Mu'tazila who came, and then what did they say? Manzilatun bayna al-manzilatayn. The person is not a kafir, nor is he a mu'min. Who did they agree with? The Khawarij. The Mu'tazila agreed with the Khawarij by saying that this person is what? How they agreed with the Khawarij? Because even though they said that we're not going to say he's a believer or a kafir, but in the Day of Judgment he's in the hellfire forever. So they've only differed with the Khawarij in this world. Because the Khawarij are able to say you're a kafir, the Mu'tazili would say to you, manzilatu bayna al-manzilatayn, you're not a mu'min, nor are you a kafir. So what about the Day of Judgment? The Day of Judgment, you're in the hellfire forever. So you really agree with the Khawarij. You agree with the Khawarij. And last but not least, the last one, which is Al-Qadha wal-Qadr. Matters pertaining to Al-Qadha wal-Qadr, the predestinies. And inshallah ta'ala, we're going to speak about the four pillars that the Qadr stands on. The four pillars in which the Qadr, which is the Maratib al-Qadr, the levels of Qadr. If a person affirms those four, which is Al-Khalqu, wal-ilmu, wal-mashi'ah, and so Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He creates, and Kitaba, which is the last one. So is Al-Khalqu, wal-ilmu, wal-mashi'atu, wal-kitaba. That Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He creates, Allah has knowledge, Allah wills, and Allah writes, subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you don't believe those four levels, and we're going to speak about it when we come to it, inshallah ta'ala, those four levels, then you go against Ahlul Sunnah in issues of qada and qadar. Also, the qada wal qadar, where enters it? Khalq af'al al-ibad. Did Allah create the people's actions? Did Allah create actions what you did? Na'am, Allah says in the Quran, wallahu khalaqakum wa ma ta'amaloon. Allah created that you guys and also what you guys do. You see? And Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, he wrote a whole book on this issue. He called it what? Khalq af'ali? Khalq af'ali al-ibad. That Allah created your actions. Who is he refuting here? The qadariyatul mujbira and the qadariyatul nufat. Who said that the person is what? He's mujbir. He has no choice. He's a flying leaf on a windy day. He's all over the place. His actions, him committing the zina is nothing with his own will. They strip the will from the person. They say that this person is committing zina because he's been forced into it. He's mujbar. He's been forced into it. You see? Then, ala kulli hal, those five are what? Usul Ahlul Sunnah. And Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, his Aqidatul Wasatiyyah, he speaks about these five and he brings the ijma' that these five have to be taken. Anyone who goes against Ahlul Sunnah in these five, he's what? He becomes a mubtadi'. He becomes an innovator. Na'am. So that was the second point. The third thing, the first one I mentioned was the place where you take your evidences from. The second one was these five. The third one, inshallah ta'ala, is what? The third one is what? Anybody who a lot of sub-branches come together, he becomes a mubtadi' because of it. If you have so many furu', if the sub-branches become too much that you have with you, they're not fundamental points, but they are so many furu', sub-branches. Al-Imam al-Shatibi, rahimahullah ta'ala, in his book Al-I'tisam, he mentions that the person yasiru mubtadi'an, he becomes a mubtadi' because of it. So those three are what? Takes a person out of Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah. And you all have to remember the statement of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, where he said, rahimahullah ta'ala, ikhraju an-nasi min as-sunnati shadidun. Taking the people out of the Sunnah is a very serious matter. Taking the people out of what? Taking the people out of the Sunnah is a very serious matter. It's not a light matter. So we have to look at these qawa'id, al-kulliyat. It's not easy to just throw a ruling that say fulan is a mubtadi'. So those five points that I mentioned, all keep it with you all the time and learn these five. How did Ahlul Sunnah? These five, where do you take it from? Al-Kitabu wa Sunnah bi fahmi salaf al-Ummah and the Ijma'. Very good. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he started with the issue of the Sahabas. He started with the issue of what? the issues of the Sahabas. So we'll start with that, inshallah, ta'ala. The Shaykh said, rahimahullah ta'ala, حب الصحابة كلهم لي مذهب ومودة القربى بها أتوصلوا. حب الصحابة loving the companions. The Shaykh said, حب الصحابة كلهم. Loving the companions, all of them. لي مذهب is my methodology. It's my method that I am upon. Also, ومودة القربى بها أتوصلوا. And also loving who? Also loving the family of who? The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I get closer to Allah. It's one of the tawassul I do. I get closer to Allah by loving who? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family. Here there's a waqfa. You have to stand over this, very important. The Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, he is mentioning that he loves the Sahabas, all of them, jami'an, min ghayri istithna, without any exception. The Sahabas, there's no exception. All of them. And that's our methodology. We do not say we hate a companion. All of them are what? All of them are loved to us. And the Sahabas, Ikhwani, they have Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala who done what? Adalahumullah. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he mentions in the Quran that these people, their integrity, Allah spoke about it. An extensive ayat. Rather, the Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he praised the companions قَلْبًا وَقَالِبًا. Pay attention to this. The praise that the Sahabas got is that they've been praised externally and internally. Their outer and their inner. Look what Allah said about them. مُحَمَّدٌ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ مَعَهُ أَشِدَّاءُ عَلَى الْكُفَارِ رُحَمَاءُ بَيْنَهُمْ تَرَاهُمْ رُكَّعًا. تَرَاهُمْ رُكَّعًا. So Allah is praising them externally. They pray in ruku' رُكَّعًا سُجَّدًا. That's externally. Then Allah internally praised them. يَبْتَغُونَ فَضْلًا مِنَ اللَّهِ. In their hearts, they are sincerely doing it for Allah's sake. They're not munafiqin. They're not munafiqin. Not as the Rafid al-Shi'a al-Khubatha. They mention in their book, Al-Kafi, which is the most authentic book for the Shi'a. Their most authentic book. In the second volume, page 244, Usul al-Kafi. They mention what? That إِنَّ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ وَالْأَنصَارِ كُلُّهُمْ مُرْتَدُّ. All of them became apostates. Except who? إِلَّا ثَلَاثَ, except three. They only give three exceptions. Some places they mention seven. And you know what's so sad? Ali ibn Abi Talib is not even in the three. Ali ibn Abi Talib is not even in the three for them. You see how Allah tabarak wa ta'ala blinded these people? So all of the Sahabas are what? They apostated from Islam. That's what they believe. You see? The point being, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala praised them. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. قَلْبًا وَقَالِبًا. And Allah told us in that same ayah that I was reading, that the Sahabas, the people who hate them are people who are kuffar. قَالَ تَعَالَى. Allah said in that same ayah, مُحَمَّدٌ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ مَعَهُ أَشِدَّاءُ عَلَى الْكُفَّارِ رُحَمَاءُ بَيْنَهُمْ تَرَاهُمْ رُكَّعًا سُجَّدًا يَبْتَوُونَ فَضْلًا مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرِضْوَانًا سِيمَاهُمْ فِي وُجُوهِهِمْ مِنْ أَثَرِ السُّجُودِ ذلك مثلهم في التوراة ومثلهم في الإنجيل كزرع أخرج شطأه فآزره فاستغلظ فاستوى على سوقه يعجب الزراع ليغيظ بهم الكفار. The Sahabas, why did they come out? ليغيظ بهم الكفار. So the disbelievers have hate towards them. They are people who, when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what? Anything happens to him, they stand up for him, alayhi salatu wa sallam. حب الصحابة كلهم لي مذهب. Loving the companions should be our madhab. And we should never allow anyone to insult the companions. We should never what? We should never allow anybody to what? Insult our companions. Rather, this ulama, they have transmitted ijma' that the sahabas, all of them are reliable. Ibn Abd al-Barr, he said in his kitab al-Isti'ab, where he talks about the companions, the first volume, page 8, he says, أجمع أهل الحق. The people of the Haqq are unanimously in agreement in what? مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ, from the Muslims. Not kuffar, we're talking about Muslims. وَهُمْ أَهْلُ السُّنَّةِ وَالْجَمَاعَةِ. They are the people of the Sunnah and the Jama'ah. Which is what? عَلَى أَنَّهُمْ كُلَّهُمْ, sorry, عُدُولٌ. That each and every one of the Sahabas are reliable ones. All of them. عُدُول. وَلِذَلِكَ إِبْهَامُ الصَّحَابِ لَا يَضُرُّ. The fact that a companion being anonymous in a narration doesn't harm us. As long as he's a companion. We don't need to know, because they're all reliable. Ijma'. There's no khilaf in this issue. Ibn Abd al-Barr transmitted that ijma'. Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani transmitted an ijma'. He said, "Ittafaqa ahli sunnati ala anna jami'a 'udul ala anna al-jami'a 'udul wa lam yukhalif fi dhalik illa shudhudh min al-mubtadi'a." He said, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, he said that ahli sunnati unanimously agreed upon that all of them are 'udul, reliable. And no one opposes us in this issue except shudud, shad, a fringe of what? Min al-mubtadi'at, from the innovators. Who also brought an ijma'? Zainuddin al-Iraqi brought an ijma'. Abu Ma'ali al-Juwayni rahimahullah brought an ijma'. Ibn al-Salah brought an ijma'. Ibn Kathir brought an ijma'. This is ijma' is qarnan ba'da qarn, generations after generations, the Sahaba's reliability and how high they are. ولذلك الإمام الخطيب البغدادي رحمه الله الإمام الخطيب البغدادي رحمه الله he mentions that a statement that I'm going to read inshallah ta'ala on you in his book Al-Kitab Kifayat fi ilm al-riwaya. He says, عَلَىٰ أَنَّهُ لَمْ يَرِدْ مِنَ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ فِيهِمْ شَيْءٌ مِّمَّا ذَكَرْنَا لَأَوْجَبَتِ الْحَالُ الَّتِي كَانُوا عَلَيْهَا مِنَ الْهِجْرَةِ وَالْجِهَادِ وَالنُّصْرَةِ وَبَذْلِ الْمُهْجِ وَالْأَمْوَالِ وَقَتْلِ الْآبَاءِ وَالْأَوْلَادِ وَالْمُنَاصَحَةِ فِي الدِّينِ وَقُوَّةُ الْإِيمَانِ وَالْيَقِينِ واليقين القطع على عدالتهم والاعتقاد على نزاهتهم وأنهم أفضل من المعدلين والمزكين الذين يجيئون من بعدهم أبد الآبدين. That the Sahabas, there is nothing whatsoever that takes them away from that which they were upon when the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم was alive. How they fought for the religion, how they stood up with unwavering conviction for this issue. The people who criticize the Sahabas are four groups. If you ever look at them, they're only four groups of people. The Shia, the Khawarij, and the Nawasib, and the Mu'tazila. Those are the four groups. The Shia, the Khawarij, the Nawasib, and the Mu'tazila. These are the four types of groups who open their mouths towards the Sahabas. And at a time like this, when it became critiquing the Sahabas, it became something that has spread. It is important that we stand up for it. Because wallahi, we have to remember that the Sahaba's being criticized is not something that, it's not something that is exclusive to the Sahaba's alone. Even that though, our life and everything goes for them. But it's not just them alone that the criticizing is upon. It is what they brought. ولذلك Abu Zur'at al-Razi, he said, and as Ibn Asakir brought in Tariq al-Dimashqa, He said, wallahi, he said a statement. Wallahi, لو خطت بماء الذهب. Wallahi, if it was written on the ink of gold, that wouldn't even be sufficient. What did he say? إذا رأيت الرجل يطعن في أصحاب رسول الله. If you ever see a person who slanders the companions of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, فعلم know أنه زنديق. Know that this person is a زنديق. ما معنى زنديق؟ أظهر الإسلام وأبطن الكفر. He shows Islam, but he's got what? Kufr in his heart. Why? Why is he a زنديق؟ وذلك أنه أن القرآن عندنا حق. The reason is because the Quran to us is true. والسنة عندنا حق. And the Sunnah to us is what? It's حق. وإنما نقل لنا القرآن. The people who transmitted this Quran to us. والسنن. And the Prophet's traditions. أصحاب محمد is the Prophet and his companions. وهؤلاء, these individuals who are slandering the companions, يريدون أن يجرحوا شهودنا, they want to slander our witnesses. ليبطلوا الكتاب والسنة. And why? They want to nullify the kitab and the sunnah and put it down to the ground. That's what they want. والجرح بهم أولى وهم زنادقة. And the criticism that they've directed towards the companions, they are the ones who deserve it. They're the ones who deserve it. They are زنادقة. نعم. And that is the reality. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, when he was alive, he said, لا تصبوا أصحابي, do not insult my companions. And Imam al-Bukhari narrated this in his book, in his Sahih, فضائل الصحابة, he chapter بابو قول النبي, لو كنت متخدا خليلا حديث. لا تصبوا أصحابي, do not insult my companions. Don't insult my companions. فوالذي نفسي بيده, I swear by the Lord in which my soul is in his hand. لو أن أحدكم, if one of you أنفق مثل أحد ذهبا, he gave out like the mountain of أحد, of gold, مَا بَلَغَ مُدَّ أَحَدِهِمْ. He will not reach مُدَّ أَحَدِهِمْ. مُدْ is this much. It's the full hand of a normal person's palm, like that. That which they give, if you give the mountain of Uhud of gold, and they went and they gave a handful of barley or wheat, whatever, like that, they gave it out. And you gave the mountain of Uhud. Mountain of Uhud is a chain of mountains that's together. Chain. How big it is. You see, you gave that in gold, and they just gave this one. The Prophet said, you wouldn't be equal to what they gave. Look what he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَا بَلَغَ مُدُّ مُدَّ أَحَدِهِمْ وَلَا نَصِيفَ. Nasif means what? Nasif means half of it. Even that much, he won't be equal. This much? And the Prophet even said half. So one palm of his. On what barley or wheat he gives, and you give the matter of Uhud, you won't be the same as him. Ah. You won't be like him. So you won't be like the Sahabi al-Jaleel.